ओम अज्ञानतिमिरांधस्य ज्ञानांजनशलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। नमाओं विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्तस्वामिनिति नामिने। नमस्ते सारस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्यदेशतारिणे। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौरभक्तवृंद। हरे कृष्णा कृष्ण कृष्णा हरे हरे, हरे रामा राम रामा हरे हरे। इन द सेकेंड चैप्टर ऑफ दी भगवद्गीता लॉर्ड कृष्णा इंट्रोड्यूसेस दिस subject of soul, atma, and Krishna explains in quite detail about the characteristics or the qualities of the spirit soul. We have been discussing this for the past 7 days, and it is very clear that the soul is completely different than any material thing of which we have experience. Unlike something material, the soul is completely different in terms of its nature. It is spiritual by nature. So we have already discussed that we are spirit soul, we are not the body, and the soul, the body is changing, and one who is undisturbed, one who is not bewildered by the change of body, one who is learned, one who is realized, can face death without becoming disturbed, because death is a change of body also. So we have been discussing about the different characteristics of the soul. Krishna describes that it's not just that the soul will continue to exist only after death. Even if in a battle, let us say, a person is killed by some weapons, still the soul remains without getting affected. So Krishna is describing one of the characteristics of the soul. The soul cannot be destroyed by any weapon. Nainam chindanti shastrani. We know there are so many different kinds of weapons which have got so much power to destroy so many material things. But the soul, being completely spiritual by nature, cannot be destroyed by any weapon, regardless of the power of the weapon. Then further Krishna says, Nainam dahati pavakaha. The soul cannot be burnt by fire. We know, depending on the strength of a particular fire, like in a blast furnace, even a metal like iron is completely melted, can be even burnt away to ashes. So depending on the strength of the fire, practically anything can be burnt. In fact, this whole universe at the end of Brahma's life is completely burnt away. It is destroyed by burning completely. So the power of fire, that is the power of fire, but even fire cannot destroy the soul. regardless of the strength of the particular file. Now, what does this mean? This means, Srila Prabhupada explains, that even in the sun planet, which is a fiery planet, there are living beings with suitable body for living on the sun planet. Just like here we have a body which is predominantly made of earthly element. Even though in our body there is fire, there is water, there is air, but still this body is predominantly made of earthly element. But we know that there are aquatics living in the ocean or water bodies. Now they have a suitable body to live in water. They have a body which is predominantly made of water. Then in the air, there are living beings who live in the air. They have a suitable body for living in the air. Similarly, there are living beings in the sun planet. They can live in fire. So, because they have a body suitable for living in fire. But even if, let's say, somebody's body is completely destroyed in a fire accident, still the soul is completely unaffected by fire. So, fire cannot burn the soul. Similarly, Krishna says, the soul is not wet by water. Here, wet by water means the soul cannot be destroyed by water weapon. Now, this is something which is not known to modern day people. Formerly, in the Vedic times, fire weapons used to be counteracted by water weapons. Just like by mantra, a powerful kshatriya who knew the mantra for generating different kinds of effects by the power of sound. So they would chant one mantra to release, let us say, a fire weapon. Then such a fire weapon can be counteracted by releasing a water weapon. Just like water can put out fire if the water is a huge, just like a forest fire can only be put out by a heavy rain. Similarly, a water weapon, which is like a thunderstorm, can put out can counteract a fire weapon. So even if somebody uses a powerful water weapon, still it's only the body that may be destroyed, but the soul is not destroyed. Because in a previous verse, Krishna has explained that even when the body is destroyed, the soul does not get destroyed. Na hanyate hanyamane sharire. So, does it mean that the soul is more resistant than the body? No. Soul is not something which is more resistant than the body. Soul is completely different in every respect than the body. So this nature, spiritual nature, we have to carefully understand. So Krishna is establishing the nature of the soul in so many ways to make that understanding very, very stable. We should get a stable conception of what is the soul, or who am I, or who are we. We should get a clear understanding without any doubts. So Krishna is clarifying, the soul cannot be destroyed by any regular weapon, it cannot be destroyed by any fire weapons, it cannot be destroyed by water weapons, it cannot be destroyed by wind weapon, cannot be withered by the wind, but that actually means that even a wind weapon, just like a tornado, a cyclone, A cyclone can create havoc, but nothing happens to the soul even if there is a cyclone. So the soul is not destroyed by any of these kinds of weapons. Now this also establishes a very important fact that each and every soul, each and every person, individual person, is an individual soul, and the soul, individual soul, is always existing as individual, continues to remain as individual even after liberation. There are a group of philosophers called Mayavadi philosophers, Advaitavadis. They say their philosophy is that after liberation, the soul becomes one with the with God. So this is completely refuted here in the Bhagavad Gita, that the soul cannot be cut to pieces and the soul cannot be joined. Their philosophy, the Mayavadi philosophy, states that the soul somehow became separated, chipped off from the Supreme Soul, and then the soul has to go back and join with the Supreme Soul. Of course, the scriptures describe we have to return to God. But that does not mean, returning to God does not mean we have to become homogeneously one with God. That is neither possible nor is it the fact. But the Mayavadi philosophers, they aim for liberation in which they want to become homogeneously one with God. That is simply because they have a desire to be the Lord in this material world. But actually, nobody can be really the Lord. Ultimately, in this world, everyone and everything is controlled by the Supreme Lord Krishna. Mayadhyakshena prakritihi suyate sa characharam. So when Krishna is the controller and he controls everyone in this world through the laws of nature, through the material laws, laws of karma, everybody is controlled. Just like as soon as somebody comes to this world, they get a body. The body is itself proof that we are controlled. If I am not the body, I am spirit soul. This body is imposing so many limitations on me or anybody. Their body is limiting them. So the body is not giving me the full freedom that I originally have as spirit soul, not entrapped by a body. But the Mayavadis think that I tried to lord over material nature, but I didn't succeed. Finally, they want to become God. And their idea of becoming God is we go and merge into the existence of God, and that way we become God. But that is never possible. According to this explanation in the Bhagavad Gita, the individual soul is individual, cannot be destroyed, cannot be cut, cannot be split, cannot be joined. So therefore, every individual soul is eternally individual. Eternally individual, and remain so even after liberation. Whereas the Supreme Lord, is the Supreme Soul, he is also individual, and he is the Supreme, eternally the Supreme, always. And he never comes under the influence of illusion. He is always the controller of illusory energy, he is the controller of illusion. He never comes under the control of illusion. So the Mayavadi's philosophy or theory is that each one of us is God. Somehow we have come under illusion. If we get out of illusion, again we can become God. But that is completely wrong. God is God eternally. God remains God. God was God in the past, present, future. Always God is God. And we are individual souls eternally. Past, present, future, all the time, always, eternally we are so. Then another example that is given is a spark of a fire. If there is a big fire, a very, very tiny spark of the fire, as long as it is in the fire, it retains its fiery quality. Moment it comes out of the fire, then it loses its fiery quality depending on where the spark falls. If the spark falls on a body of water, then the spark is immediately extinguished. If it falls on dry grass, then the spark can light up dry grass and there will be a fire and the spark can remain as a spark. But if a spark falls, let us say, on the ground where there is no water, it is dry ground, it may remain as a spark for some time, even after falling away from the fire. But it cannot continue to remain like that. So this example is given to help us understand that we exhibit our spiritual quality only in association with Krishna, the Supreme Spirit. When we turn away from Krishna or when we are forgetful of Krishna, we cannot exhibit our spiritual nature because we get trapped by a material body. We are placed in a material body. In the material body, the spirit soul does not mix with the body, remains always spirit, but the spiritual qualities are not exactly exhibited as they are, but they are exhibited through this body, through matter. So I have to see through these eyes. I have to smell through this nose. So even though my smelling capacity is independent of this body in my original position, in association with Krishna as spiritual being, but now in this body I am limited by whatever the body can actually offer a certain type of facility. So we should understand that our spiritual nature is properly exhibited only in association with Krishna. Just like a spark of a fire, the fiery quality is exhibited best when the spark is in the fire. Moment the spark gets separated from the fire, it cannot exhibit anymore its fiery quality. Similarly, we can't exhibit our spiritual nature when we are forgetful of Krishna, when we are away from Krishna, when we are turned away from Krishna. In this material world, we cannot, being trapped in a material body. Then Krishna also explains further qualities of the soul. The soul is unchangeable. The soul is unchangeable. Unchangeable means, just like the body, body has got six kinds of changes. It is born, it remains for some time, it grows and then it remains for some time. Then it produces byproducts, then it dwindles and it vanishes. So these six changes, Shad Vikara, applies to every type of body, every type of material body, regardless of what type of body or which species somebody is born in. But the soul does not have any of these six changes. So soul is unchangeable. Soul is all pervading. Now this all pervading sarvagata means living entities are present all over God's creation. They are there on the earth, they are there within the ground, they are there in the water, they are there in the air, they are there in the fire, they are there in the sky. Everywhere the living entities are present. Now this is different from Krishna himself, the Supreme Soul, the Supreme Lord. He is also described as all-pervading, but he is all-pervading because he is present everywhere personally. Personally and through his energy and through his representation as the Paramatma, as a Super Soul, he is present everywhere. So he is conscious of everything, he is conscious of everyone. His consciousness is unlimited. He is present in unlimited places simultaneously. So that is the nature, that's the quality or characteristics of the Supreme Lord as all pervading. Whereas when it is described the soul is all pervading, that means souls are present everywhere in God's creation, all planets. So this also helps us understand the Vedic perspective that every planet is inhabited by millions and billions and trillions of living beings. Every planet. It's not just that the Earth planet alone is inhabited and other planets are vacant. The scientists, they doubt whether there is life on other planets. They are trying to do some research to ascertain that. But the understanding from our eternal Vedic scriptures is very clear. Every planet is inhabited by living beings. That is because the soul is sarvagata. Spirit souls are present, living beings are present everywhere in God's creation. Then further Krishna describes the soul is invisible. Invisible because we can understand the dimension of the soul is 1/10,000th part of the tip of the hair point in size. So tiny, it is smaller than the material atom. So the scientists, even if they use whatever most powerful microscope, they cannot see the soul. Not only that the soul is very, very tiny, it is also of a different quality. It is spiritual by nature. Something which is spiritual cannot be seen with material vision, with these material eyes. With these eyes we can only see something that is matter, has got a material constitution. We cannot see spirit with these eyes, not possible. So to see spirit, we require spiritual vision. To see spirit, we require spiritual vision. So that spiritual vision is possible to be developed by spiritual methods, by spiritual practice, by practicing spiritual life. It is not possible by any material method. So therefore, the soul is described as invisible. And soul is described as inconceivable. That means the soul can be understood only by the proof of Vedic wisdom, Shruti, Shruti Pramana. Only by hearing from the authentic scriptures can we know about the soul, can we understand what is the soul. Can we get an idea of spiritual nature? Otherwise, it's not possible. There is no other way. There is no experimental method of trying to establish the presence of the soul. There is no experimental method. Just like the scriptures give this example, to know, for a child to know who is its father, the only authority is the mother, and there is no other way. So the soul can only be understood from this Supreme Lord who describes it, or from study of the authentic Vedic literature. So the Vedic literature are compared to Mother, and the Supreme Lord Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, is compared to the Father. So our sources of knowledge, Supreme Father Krishna and the Supreme Mother, the Vedic literature or the Shruti. Shruti is Mother and the Supreme Lord is Father. So that is the only way to know about the soul. Therefore, the soul is described as inconceivable. We can't conceive what is the soul in the mind, neither we can conceive using our intelligence. Not possible. So only by hearing from scriptures or hearing from the spiritual master who is a representative of Krishna, or directly hearing from Krishna, as Arjuna is doing. Then the soul is described as immutable. Immutable means the soul does not become God. This is very important to understand. The soul cannot become God. Individual soul, as I already told, cannot become one with God. Neither soul can become God by some meditation or by some yoga. No, it's not possible for the soul to become God. So this establishes the stability of the conception of the soul, as Krishna is explaining in the Bhagavad Gita. And it's also explained in the Upanishads. Many of the verses of the Bhagavad Gita are confirmed in the Kathopanishad, in the Shvetashvatara Upanishad, in the Mundaka Upanishad. So many verses similar to what is explained in the Bhagavad Gita. Then Krishna also establishes the fact that some people consider the soul to be also destructible. Their idea is, just like this body is destroyed at the time of death, they think if there is something called a soul, oh, that is also destroyed at the time of death. There are some philosophers who follow some philosophy called Lokayatika and Vaibhashika. They are two different kinds of philosophers. Their theory is that life symptoms appear or take place in a mature condition of some material combination. They give the example, just like if we prepare take a fruit and extract the juice of the fruit, let's say grape juice, and you keep that grape juice, when it starts fermenting, so many living entities will appear or take birth in that medium. So their theory is that like a fermented grape juice, so many living entities are taking birth. Similarly, when a certain combination of material elements becomes a suitable mature combination, then the different kinds of living beings are taking birth. Just like in a rice sack, there may be some small scorpion which is taking birth. Vrishchika Tandula Nyaya. This is pointed out as a fallacious logic, that we see sometimes that in a rice sack, when we stored the rice, there was no scorpion, but when the rice bag is opened, suddenly some scorpion is coming out of it. So where did the scorpion come from? Within the rice sack, which was sealed, and before sealing it was ensured that there was only rice and nothing else. So the mother scorpion had laid the eggs in the middle of the rice. And those eggs, when they get a suitable medium to actually incubate, then the eggs are hatching and the baby scorpions are coming out. So the cause of the baby scorpion coming out of the rice sack is actually the egg inside the rice sack. It is not the rice, but the rice sack, rice provided the medium, the warmth of the mass of rice grains that gave a sufficiently suitable condition for the scorpion to take birth from the egg. Just like a soul takes shelter of a father, and through the father combining with the mother, the living being is injected into the mother's womb. Now the mother's womb is a suitable place for the body to develop, but the soul is not generated by some chemical combination of sperm and ovum. No, it's only the body which is actually generated that way by such combination. It is not the soul. So the soul doesn't take come into being at the time of birth. It is the body which comes into being. So similarly, this theory of the lokayatikas and vaibhashikas, that some material combination, when it matures, then there is life symptoms appearing, some living being is taking birth. No. It may be that that combination of matter may be a suitable combination, is a suitable place of birth for some living beings, only in terms of the body being generated that way, but not the spirit soul. And unless the spirit soul takes shelter of a particular body, the body will never develop. Just like a child is born as a stillborn child, miscarriage. A child may be in a mother's womb developing nicely, but before the child comes out, sometimes it dies in the womb. That means the spirit soul has left the body. Then the body will not develop any further. It cannot develop any further. So similarly, every living being, when there are life symptoms, that is due to the presence of the soul. It is never due to any body or material combination. So Krishna is pointing out that if somebody thinks that life is due to some material combination, then Krishna is telling Arjuna, if you think like that, then what is the need for lamenting about the loss of just some chemicals? Of course, Krishna is sarcastically telling Arjuna, I don't expect you will accept this fallacious logic that the soul is destroyed or the soul is a result of a material combination or living symptoms are due to material combination. Krishna does not expect Arjuna, who belongs to the Vedic culture, to accept this argument. But just in case, even if Arjuna were to argue that ultimately everything is going to be destroyed, even the soul will be destroyed at the time of death, then what is the loss? Where is the loss? There is no loss. So either way, considering the soul is indestructible, soul is immutable, soul is inconceivable, soul cannot be destroyed anyway, so there is no loss. And if somebody thinks the soul also is destroyed, then where is the loss? So in either case, Arjuna is advised to actually do his duty of fighting in this Dharma Yuddha as a Kshatriya. Then Krishna establishes that one who has taken birth is sure to meet with death after finishing a certain term of life within a particular body. Jatasya hi dhruvo mrityuhu. It is a fact, established fact, that after birth, a certain duration of time, varying durations of time in different bodies, different types of bodies, there is certainly going to be death. And after death, dhruvam janma mritasya cha, one who dies is sure to take birth again. So this also establishes that the soul is not going to be destroyed. When the soul has entered a particular body, it is going to quit that body and enter another body. So both Bhishma, Drona and all the noble souls, they would change their body at the time of death to get a better next body, because they are all pious people. So there is no need for lamentation by Arjuna about the death of his respectable superiors in this Dharma Yuddha. So Dharma Yuddha ensures that whoever dies fighting in this Dharma Yuddha will get a better next life, guaranteed. So therefore Arjuna had no reason to lament. I'll try to answer some questions. We have a question by somebody which is as follows. We have to become one with God. What is this oneness? Please explain. This oneness with God, there is such a description in the Shastras, in the various scriptures, that God is completely spiritual by nature. We are also spiritual by nature. God is conscious being. We are also conscious beings. But even though we are same in quality with God, we are spiritual by quality. God is also spiritual by quality. But we are quantitatively very, 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 very tiny as spirit soul. We are limited. We are infinitesimal. This is a mathematical term. God is infinite. God is unlimited. God is the sum total of everything in existence, and he has got his separate individuality also. So God possesses unlimited strength, unlimited power, unlimited wealth, unlimited everything. We may have some small amount of wealth or small amount of beauty or whatever, but we are always having everything in limited proportion. So we are tiny. We are Anu. Anu means atomic. God is Vibhu. Vibhu means unlimited. So the oneness with God is only in terms of our spiritual nature. As long as we are in this material body, we are not able to exhibit our actual spiritual nature. So when we become self-realized, when we become liberated, when we get back our association with Krishna in his kingdom, in his spiritual abode, then we are able to exhibit our spiritual nature in association with Krishna in devotional service. Our association with Krishna is in serving Krishna as a devotee. That's what Krishna explains in the Bhagavad Gita. He says, final instruction, become my devotee. Think of me always. Man mana bhava mad bhakto madhyaji maam namaskuru. Because our position is that, original position is, we are devotees of Krishna. We are meant to serve Krishna out of love and devotion. So the oneness is only in terms of quality, but quantitatively we can never become equal to Krishna at any stage. Does the next question, does the spirit soul suffer? If so, when does the spirit soul suffer? This question probably is asked in connection with, if I pinch somebody's hand, then there is feeling of pain. Now, who is actually suffering the pain? Is it the body, or is it the mind, or is it the intelligence, or is it the soul? So we should understand that all experiences are of the soul, because it's the soul which has got consciousness. The body actually is dead matter. Mind is matter, material. Material means there is no consciousness. The intelligence is also material. Body, mind, intelligence, all are material. The soul is spiritual. The soul has got consciousness. So any experience of happiness or distress with reference to the body or mind is experienced by the soul or the person within. But if you ask whether the soul suffers, actually the soul has no suffering, because soul is just an observer, experiencer and observer. The experience is just like it is coming and going. Just like if any distress is there, that comes and goes. Any happiness, it comes and goes. Everything material is a phenomena that lasts for a limited duration of time. And just like this body itself, what to speak of suffering in the body? The body itself is temporary. So how can any happiness or distress with respect to this body or mind be permanent? That's never the case. So it's always temporary, and therefore they come and go. But the experience is of the soul. The soul is experiencing. Now, when we become self-realized within this body, then we don't identify with the body or the mind, then we can actually tolerate, or we need not be affected by the condition of the body or condition of the mind or happiness or distress pertaining to the body and mind. We can be aloof from it if we become self-realized. That means we realize our identity as spirit soul. We realize our spiritual nature. That is possible by practice of bhakti yoga. By bhakti yoga, if we become situated in devotional service to Krishna, then we become immune to all kinds of happiness and distress pertaining to this body. I'll stop here. Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Thank you.